Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So today I'm actually going to be doing something a little bit different. So this whole video is going to be a training based video, although I'm sitting here in my office right now. I am just putting together a couple of brand new programs. So what's kind of unique about this is that basically all the exercises, bar maybe a couple of key compound movements that you'll have all done before, this is a brand new slate for me as well. I haven't done some of these exercises. So obviously I like to make sure that you guys are entertained and you're enjoying your training programming just as much as I am. And I think exercise diversity is really important from a, consistency, accountability perspective. Because if you're not enjoying your training, you're not gonna go. So I have to be creative and I continue to find new movements. So I have just finished putting together a few of these workouts. So today, in no particular order, I'm actually just going to show you all of these new movements. So I don't know how the pairing of these movements is going to feel. And as you guys probably know, I've talked about this before. When I give you guys a program, I've done it first and I want to make sure that it flows nicely. It's not too much, it's not too little. You know, there's not too many single leg movements in one program and it just takes forever. So today, it's gonna be a little bit of a wild card because usually I film these videos when I've already done them and I'm like, yes, this is a great program. So we're gonna have to see. But let me read out a couple of these new exercises for you because I've got two workouts. I'm gonna be doing one today and then I'm gonna film another one for you tomorrow. So we'll start with this lower body session. So we've got up first a Smith Machine banded pulse squat. So you'll be able to see this is a really cool, unique way to do some squats and it really targets your lower glutes, which you guys know that that's the best muscle group obviously to train. So then we are moving on to a box step up using the cables. So I've seen this done quite a bit. Some of you may have already done this exercise, but it's not one that I have done. So I think I've done every single dumbbell, barbell, Smith Machine variation of step ups. So I am now taking it to the cables. We are also going to be doing a deficit split squat pulse. So we've obviously done lots of different lunges and split squats. We've done Bulgarians. Today, I figure we're gonna keep it nice and low, working those partial ranges of motion, specifically the final range of motion, so where the muscle is lengthened. And then we're going to be doing an incline bench glute kickback. So again, I've never done this before. I don't know whether you guys have done this, but I've obviously been spending way too much time at the glute lab with Brett and watching all the girls because these are some really killer exercises. We're gonna do some blood flow restriction today. So I think I might have talked about this in some previous videos, but blood flow restriction is just one of the many kind of fancy training techniques that essentially allows you to build muscle. So we do it through occluding your, venous return. We're gonna put something relatively tight around, the distal part of your muscle that we're trying to train. And it's a tough process, so I'm gonna do that. We've also got some, banded sumo adductions. These are really awkward. It's like a creepy exercise to look at, but they definitely get the job done when it comes to glutes. And then we're also going to be using some ankle weights today, which is not something that I've done in a long time, for some hanging knee raises. So that's kind of what's on tap for today's program. I'm going to read out the exercises for the other program probably tomorrow. I won't give too much away, but I'm really psyched to do this. It's gonna be tough, lots of glutes as you can see. Yeah, I think this is probably gonna be one of the ones that goes up onto our new workout platform. So very excited. Okay, so before we jump into the gym, I actually wanna go through a couple of different pieces of equipment that I have just ordered. Obviously, Miss Ray is very excited to try all of these new pieces of equipment. So last night, I actually went online and ordered some of these lacrosse balls. So I've actually never owned lacrosse balls. So I'm really sore. And I think part of the reason is that I've been sitting down on my desk for so many more hours. So I used to use my stand-up desk and we've been showing the house. So as an aesthetic person would do, I took out my big ugly stand-up desk, and it's meant that I've been sitting so much more. So this is going to come in handy for that. So the bigger ball is for your larger muscle groups, working all the way down to something that's a little bit smaller, which I'll probably use for like my calves, under my foot arch, and maybe on my back as well. And then I used to have some of these ankle weights. I don't know where they got into, so I bought some new ones. These actually have adjustable weights in them. So they go from, I think, 2 pounds all the way up to 10. So these are actually really going to come in handy for some of the glute exercises, particularly an abduction where we're taking our leg out to the side. Also some of the kickback exercises as well. So this is actually pretty stout, and I'm going to be using these for some of the core movements too, because if you are anything like me and you've been training for a little while, doing body weight core exercises really doesn't challenge your muscle very much. In fact, I'd probably have to do 100 crunches before I'm even getting near to failure. So this way, by putting these ankle weights on when I'm doing like a leg lower, like a decline, or today I'm going to be doing some hanging knee tucks, this makes it a lot more challenging. So I can basically fatigue my muscle faster. So from a time efficiency standpoint, this is much better. And that's why I also choose to do weighted core movements. You don't really see me doing like circuits of core very often because, number one, it's time consuming, but it just doesn't challenge me very much. So excited for those. And then with some of these new glute exercises that I was telling you about before, we're going to need quite a few of these different loop bands. So these are like your pull-up assist band. You can get these in various resistances. They usually come in like a pack of five. For the exercise that we're going to do today, you're going to need two. You can either use the really thin ones, depending on where the pegs are on your Smith machine. You may be able to use the slightly thicker one. If you don't have to stretch it very far, if they've got nice positions for the pegs. If you don't have a Smith machine that's got pegs on it, we'll be wrapping it all the way around, all the way up to where the weights actually sit on the side of the bracket. So bands is also something that you're going to need for some of these programs. So all up, I think you can get these online for about $19 to $29 for a pack of five. These bad boys, I think we're at $14.95. I'll put all the links here for you. So if you want to grab any of them, you can. And then the lacrosse balls, there were certainly cheaper ones available, but I needed to get mine overnight because I only got these yesterday. So that limited my selection, but I did really like these because they came in a pack of three, and these were about $42, and they are pretty sturdy. So I don't expect that these will, I don't know, break or, you know what happens to your equipment. So $42 is what these ones cost. So let's head to the gym and we'll get started. So I am just doing a little bit of light, rolling. I haven't done this in such a long time, and this is just really, it's highlighted the fact that I have absolutely neglected myself over the last 7 months. I think I've had two massages, and that is just absurd for me. I think as somebody that's always done sport my whole life, like even when I was like track sprinting as a 12-year-old, like my mom always had us at the physical therapist, or we were getting massage like weekly. So yeah, I think as I've gotten older, obviously you have more and more responsibilities, less time. I'm actually very lucky that I am not injured, but I'm very tired. But my training's certainly been at a lower intensity this year. Just with everything that's kind of been going on and massive transitions with business, new companies, new team, new projects, writing books, running challenges. So yeah, my training has definitely suffered, but my recovery, unfortunately, has too. So I won't do too much deep work. And you want to avoid doing too much deep work. Thank you. Before you go and lift, and particularly if you are somebody that is focused on like performance-based sports. So different story if you're going in and you're just training strictly for aesthetics and you're trying to get more muscular, even right down to some of the research on like static stretching versus dynamic stretching. Honestly, there probably isn't enough convincing evidence, at least that I've read yet, that would skew me from not doing a static stretch before I resistance train from a building muscle perspective. If I was going into the gym and I was doing heavy lifting and strength specific work, then there is some research that suggests that static stretching actually impedes your strength outcomes. So yeah, I don't know whether that helps you guys or not, but I'm just going to do a little bit of this today. The other spot that I really saw in is like right up in your subscap. Oh my god, I just felt everything crack. That is ridiculous. This is a bit too painful for you. All right, so today's session is all lower body. So usually I would probably do some more dynamic stretching and some mobility for my upper body. I don't know that I need to do too much today. I would do a couple. The first one that I'm going to show you though is for activating your core. So this is called a psoas march. I'm using, I guess, this brand of bands because they were pink. Definitely exploring that femininity. Okay, so start off with, you want to have your knees at right angles here. You're going to inhale, exhale, and on the exhale, we're going to extend one of our feet out lengthwise, and the other is going to be pulling back. You're trying to keep this angle here exactly as it was when you started. So you don't want to have it letting you pull forwards. So I'm just going to do a few reps so that you can see. So you can see me really focusing on my breathing. Inhale, exhale. Inhale, exhale. So I'm going to go through and do about 20 of those. And this is a really great exercise if you're somebody that has weak intra-abdominals and weak hip flexors, which is not that uncommon if you're somebody that sits all day like I do. So this is kind of strengthening and lengthening. So a lot of us tend to forget about the strengthening component. Let's be real, actually, a lot of us forget about the lengthening, stretching part altogether. So probably do both. You can really see like my abs are having to stabilize here to keep this knee from pulling forwards. So that is a real, like if I sit up, that's quite challenging. So obviously start with something that's a bit easier to begin with. So that's one exercise. I'm also gonna do another one that you might have seen me do before with one of our coaches, Coach Shannon. She's a physical therapist and specializes in athletics performance. So she's a volleyballer, but also does weightlifting, Olympic lifting. And she actually taught me this one, so it's nothing universal, but certainly good for abduction, which we're going to be doing quite a bit of today. So foot goes up on the mirror and we're just going to abduct like this. So keeping your core in, rotating out. I can already feel that really working through my hip. So I'm going to do 10 per side. So this band's probably a little bit easy. So what you can do is double it up. All right, so I've doubled it up. That might be a little bit more challenging now. Again, stabilizing, hands on the hips in that forward like athletic stance. Yeah, that's way better. So you can see I just kind of roll out on the side of my heel. And again, like I can feel my whole body at the moment just shaking. Thank you. Okay. All right, so I am going to do a couple of upper body, exercises. So just starting off with a resistance band, or if you've got a timber plank or dowel, whatever you've got that allows you to get slightly wider than shoulder width. And we're just going to do 20 of those over and back. And then as you feel like your joints are warming up and all the soft tissue, those ligaments, tendons, are moving a little bit more freely, then I usually just kind of come in a knuckle width, do the same thing. So that's a lot more of a stretch now. I may be able to go a little more, but I also don't want to injure myself. So I'll come in half an inch. Yeah. And that is about as far as I want to go. Let me just see in the mirror here what that looks like. So one of the things that I've been noticing when I do a lot of my pressing exercises, maybe you guys can see this, when I'm in this position, sometimes one of my shoulders tends to pop more forwards. So I've got to really focus on getting this one out. Otherwise, I'm kind of coming down in a chest press and this side kind of gets stuck. So this is actually probably something that I should be doing a little bit more to make sure that I've got plenty of flexibility through my lats, because I think it's like a posterior issue. Or maybe I'm really tight in my chest. I don't know, I need to get into a physical therapist. I might try and call upon our coaches. So then we're gonna do some pull aparts. So again, just probably 2 to 3 sets of 10. And I'm gonna think about suppressing my lats down, pulling apart. I already got a sweat up. So again. All right, so the next one, you've probably seen me do this before. Again, this is another hip opener. We are gonna be doing a lot of abduction today. So I wanna make sure that I'm definitely feeling nice and warm in my hips. So we're going to loop it around the base of something that's fixed. Pop your foot in, walk that out so there's a good amount of tension on that band. And then you're gonna come down into a half kneeling squat. And again, we're gonna rotate. So this is similar to the exercise that you would have seen me doing before with the mini bands. So again, this is a little bit more tension. I probably prefer this one better, but it's only because I've been doing so much abduction work. I've probably got very strong glutes. So if you are kind of new to training, the exercise that I did this morning with the mini bands is probably better. So we're gonna swap it over. Sorry, I got my back to you. You can see walking it out. Ooh, coming down into that position. You can see that's really pulling my knee in. So I'm really thinking about sucking in through my core and then rolling out. This is actually a great resistance for me. Not having done this in a little while, I should say, I probably like this better than using the mini loop bands around my knees for abductions. And if you are somebody that has, I guess, shallow hip sockets, if you've got a really deep hip socket, like a groove, imagine you've got your femur and it kind of sits in that socket, you've got deep sockets, you tend to not have as much range of motion with your abduction or extension. I have really shallow sockets. At least that's what I see in my x-rays. So like my hip socket's a lot shallower. So I have a lot more range of motion with my hips. So the normal banded exercises, when I'm doing like a glute abduction, just sitting, it doesn't necessarily get me to a good range of motion. I'd probably do this instead because it really allows me to roll out on my ankle and really achieve that length that I have naturally. So for that, I usually do 2 sets, 10 per side. And then last one, just some cross hack lunges. So we are doing squats today. We're starting with squats, with sumo. The adductors actually get used quite a lot when you are squatting. Hardly any hamstring
but a lot of quad and a lot of glute, and that will depend on your anatomy. So if you've got a really long spine or you've got really long femurs, maybe you've got both, you probably have a lot more forward leaning squat, and that means that you're probably going to be more posterior chain, so you'll use your glutes more. If you're short spine and or short femur, your squat will probably be a lot more upright, and therefore you'll be a little bit more anterior dominant, so you'll use your quads more. So I'm extremely forward leaning because I've got really long spine and femurs, so I actually have to program specifically like an upright squat to really activate my quads as much as the average person. So I try to incorporate a little bit of both. So one of my squat days, I'll be in the forward leaning position. I know I'm targeting my glutes. And then I'll do a more vertical squat, which might even be heels elevated to get my quads. So yeah, that's definitely gonna be in this next program. Alrighty, so after like 45 minutes of setup, we finally got this. So as someone that's done powerlifting and plenty of banded squats, this was just like, sorry. We are trying to create tension, I guess, on the ascent. So what I've got here is two bands. I'm using, I guess, the second lightest band. It's probably not giving me quite enough tension, to be honest. And I don't want to loop these bands around too many times because they're probably not cut out for the job. So I'm gonna have to use slightly heavier weights today than I had planned for this to be challenging. But essentially on the ascent, we've now got resistance the entire time. So it's a lot more challenging than just doing it as a free weight. So there's constant tension. So you can see both are at the bottom and I'm cracking up inside my mind right now, but so we, because there wasn't enough tension, we were just like, oh, okay, so, oh, well, we need to loop it the reverse. And then like that's when you overload your weight and it's helping you on the way up. So anyhow, both at the bottom, looping around, and it's pretty simple. So let's get started. Okay, so I'm gonna do like two or three warm-up sets just to kind of test the weight and work up to an appropriate load. So for a squat, for a compound lift, I usually do, I guess it depends whether we're doing free barbell or a machine, but probably recommend doing 3 to 5 warm-up sets if you were doing a compound lift like a squat or a deadlift or any variation of. But for smaller muscle groups, you probably only need to do 1 or 2. So I started at 25, that was pretty comfortable. We're working through to 15 reps for this exercise, a slightly higher rep range. So that's probably closer to a working set. So I just did 10 reps. We're good. So this will probably be whatever you normally load up for your regular Smith machine squat. Take off like 20%. It's a lot harder. How many did you get?
I did like 50.
50. Oh, smart ass. Oh man. Yeah, that's gonna be my working weight. Yeah, so I think what I would typically do, I haven't got my a phone here with my normal program, but I would go back and look at what I've done for previous squats on the Smith machine. Look at your, I guess because it's the first week moving into a new program, I wouldn't be jumping into your best weight or using that to calculate what you should be doing for today's lift. It's essentially a deload in week one to kind of get you familiar with all the movements. You're already going to be slow anyway, so deload week one, choosing something that's probably in the midpoint, and then that is where I would recommend calculating your 20% less. for the same rep range. So this is definitely tough. Right, so this is a sumo squat. So you're going to take your feet a little bit wider than what you would normally for your regular squat. So that is good for me. So I actually took it back down and just put 10s on because I wanted to hit the rep range today. I don't want to be doing like low rep ranges because I have another training day later this week that'll be like moderate to low. So yeah, I went back down. So, like I said, I haven't done this since I did powerlifting, and it certainly wasn't on a Smith machine. It was just on a free barbell. It really helps with your bottom range strength. So for most of us, the place where you tend to get stuck in a squat, you're coming down, you're trying to come back up, and this is where you hit a bit of a weak point. So this is right where that tension lands. Starts to kick back in, so it really forces you to contract to kind of get through the rest of that range of motion. So yeah, this is a fun one. Okay, so the next exercise we're going to be doing is a box step up using the cables. So I prefer to use one of these armed cable machines. Usually the weight is a little bit more challenging. This side's broken today, so I'm gonna wait for this gentleman to finish. But we are isolating our glutes here as much as possible. So you're gonna get some quad involvement. Your hamstrings shouldn't really be doing a whole lot of work, but we're going to be in a really forward leaning position, and we're gonna have opposite foot to hand, and we're gonna be stepping up, slowly coming back down and just kind of lightly tapping that back foot. I've done these before with dumbbells, but this is the first time that I've done them with the cable. So this is one that I did with Brett a few weeks ago. And again, there's nothing magical about this compared to using a dumbbell or using the Smith machine like I had in my last program. It really is just for exercise diversity, and sometimes you'll discover a new muscle. So this one, I definitely felt it in my glutes, my lower glutes, which is where most people struggle the most to feel it. So high box if you're brand new, low box, the higher up, the harder it gets. You need to have a lot more stability for an exercise when it's up high and you've got a bigger angle. So let's get this set up. I think I picked the sweatiest, hottest day to come and train, and I had my hair out. Okay. All right, so we want to have the box positioned as close as possible to your cable. You can do this on all kinds of cables. I cannot stand these boxes. They are so heavy and annoying, but they don't actually have any like Reebok steps or anything. So if you've got something that's lightweight, like a little, what are they, like the box jump, and they come in like a set of five, something that's more malleable, that would be perfect for this. So I've got this lovely heavy box. It's positioned nice and close. You want to have your arm set on the lowest point of the cable. So yeah, this can't go any lower. Start with a relatively light weight. Again, we're going to go opposite hand to leg, foot, and getting into that forward lean position like I said before, and slowly coming down. Now you can see here, I haven't really quite got enough range of motion. Like there's no tension here. So if you've got a attachment like this that's got multiple hooks, make sure that you have got enough range. So I'm going to put it on the shortest one, so now I can actually get down a little bit lower. So you can see now when I come down, I've still got tension here. So coming down, lightly tap that back foot. If you've got a partner to hold on to, you can do that, or if you have something in front of you. Perfect. All right, so today I'm going to do two sets of 12 per side. All right, so one thing that you do want to do with this exercise is make sure that you are as close to the edge of your bench as comfortable and practical. If you're somebody that doesn't have good balance, maybe give yourself like an inch and a half, but ultimately the closer you can be to the edge, the smoother the plane is that you're going up and down. Otherwise, if you've got, I guess, a big distance here, well, now you're going down with your hips out in this angle, right? You're almost abducted. So we want to keep in like that nice neutral plane so that you're not having to open up your hips. So to do that, nice and close to the edge, and also come right to the front of the box as well. All right, okay guys, so up next, oh God, I'm puffing this like a, I don't know, it's hot. Deficit split squat pulses. So in, not my last program, the program before, we definitely had deficit or front foot elevated split squats, and we were doing pulses, but this time we are going to be doing it. Actually, you know what? Last time it wasn't pulses. We were just doing reverse lunges. So we were coming back up, and this was one of Mark Carroll's exercises. I think it's called the Mark Carroll because he was kind of coming in like this. Today we're going to be staying down in that low position, like at that final initial range of motion. So we've got maximum stretch and length through your glute and through your hamstring. So we're going to be taking with two dumbbells, coming down nice and low. Careful not to actually bump your knee. You want to stay just above, and we're going to be staying in this position. So 20 reps, so high rep ranges. So you're going to feel all of that accumulative metabolites building up in your legs, and it's going to feel horrible. So we can, I guess, cause our muscles to grow through multiple stimulus. This is one way that you can train, and I know a couple of people that really enjoy training with high rep ranges. It's just how they've done it. They like to sweat. To me, it's cardio. but it can be effective provided that you are still working close to failure. So unlike, like if we were doing heavy lunges with, you know, I might have like 100 pound dumbbells, I might only be doing, you know, six reps. That, I guess, mechanical load, that heavy load is what would signal my muscle to become fatigued and then to grow. So light weights today, light load, high rep ranges. It's gonna suck. All right, so I'm actually gonna use wraps for this. Even though it's a lightweight, I'm doing a lot of reps and I'm still trying to get to failure. So in efforts to not, I guess, limit my potential, or at least the potential of my legs to get to failure, which is likely going to happen because I've got weak grip strength. And these are really my limitation. So I'm gonna use the wraps so that I can really focus on my quads. It's not cheating, it's smart, and I probably should also at some point work on developing my grip strength. So these are my accessory sponsor, my training sponsor, Iron Tanks. So I shout these guys out all the time. Sam and Naya actually used to go to college with me, and I worked at his restaurant. Like, might be his dad's restaurant, but he was the chef. and I was a waitress there when I was at university, and yeah, small world. So I have his products, his wraps, his knee sleeves, his lifting belt, pretty much everything. So again, I'll put the links and everything to all of the gear that I use at the moment. Oh my gosh, I don't even think that was 20 reps. So that's deceiving. The first leg was not so bad. Second leg, oh my God. Is that what happened to you?
Second leg,
yeah. This next exercise is, I guess, a benched glute kickback. So there's a couple of ways that you can do this, and it really depends on, I guess, how comfortable you are when you're going through the motions. So I'm somebody that really gets quite a fatigued back pretty early on into a set, as my glutes are dead. So I prefer to do a scoop instead of a straight leg. You can imagine your moment arm, when you've got a straight leg, there's a lot more tension at my lower back. If I can keep things a little bit more center of gravity, I feel a lot more in control, and I'm not loading up my spine or my lower back muscles quite as much by keeping that bent knee here in this position rather than straight. So you can do straight kickbacks, or we can do what I guess is a scoop. Traditionally I would do this standing on a cable, but this just makes it that little bit more challenging because you've now got less stability. So you're going to come up onto the bench. You can have two hands here. If you're on a regular cable that's got a cable tower, you can put your hands on the tower. But for me here today, I'm going to be doing this position. So yeah, I really like this one. Great glute. I can really feel that up in my glute max. It's good. All right. I don't know whether I like using it on this cable tower, just because to feel like you're comfortable and stable, you want to have something to grab onto. And I personally don't feel like I have enough stability just holding onto the bench. So if I'm to tell you what exercise to do, obviously I always will go for a standing kickback, as you've seen me do a billion times. But for some diversity in your movement, still use the bench because it does make it more challenging, but use a cable with a cable tower where you can hold on to the seat with one hand and then extend the other arm out. Awesome. All right. Okay. So the next exercise, I've skipped ahead one. I'm going to come back to that because I needed to get my blood flow restriction bands, but we are going to be doing a heels elevated squat pole. So a lot of partial range motion, at least that I'm experimenting with in this program. So I have these wedges here. These are super lightweight. The previous pair that I had were so heavy, and my training bag, just to kind of walk around, was probably like 30 pounds. So not good for your back. So I found these lighter ones and they come with a couple of different thicknesses for the wedge. So this is one of the higher ones. There's one more that's a little bit higher, but again, to get something like this, and these are squat wedges, I'm pretty sure is the term that I searched when I was looking these up, but again, I'll try to get the links for you and put them in the description. But great if you are somebody like me that struggles to engage your quads when you're squatting. Obviously, I've got quite a forward squat because I have long femurs. So for me to squat and isolate my quads a little bit more, I really need to have a heel elevated. So we are going to be using these. And again, if you don't have access to kettlebells, you can do this with dumbbells. You can do this with pretty much anything. If you've got a barbell, preferably a Smith machine, because you want something to really control this movement. And you can do this as a goblet style, which is when you hold, I guess if it's a dumbbell or a kettlebell, like so. So this would be your goblet. Coming down in a pulse position, keeping it really close to your chest. You don't want to hold it out, especially as that load gets heavier. Or if you've got access to some heavier kettlebells or heavy dumbbells, we can also do this position. So just letting it hang down between your feet. So the goblet is going to be more challenging because you're using your full body. You're having to hold that weight here close in your chest, so it's going to feel more challenging. I'm actually going to go the kettlebell and hang it down in between my legs for this set. So I'm positioning these just slightly wider than my shoulders, toes facing out and coming down. So super lightweight here. For me, I'd probably have to go to somewhere around 40 reps for that to be challenging. If you've got access to a heavier load and you're time poor, do that because it's going to cut your rep range in half and fatigue your muscles much faster. So that's it. I'm going to be doing two sets of 20, obviously at a heavier weight, but that is your heels elevated squat pulse. Okay, all right, so I have Dr. Samuel Buckner with me today. He is from the University of South Florida. He is my buddy, and he is going to be here demonstrating a bunch of exercises today. But I wanted you to talk through blood flow restriction because that is our next exercise, and this is one of your areas of specialty. So do you want to explain a little bit more about what blood flow restriction is, what we've got here, how are we putting it on, all those kind of things?
Sure, yeah, so... Blood flow restriction, as its name kind of implies, is restricting blood flow while you exercise. To a lot of people, it's counterintuitive because a lot of people take vasodilators. They actually try to increase blood flow during exercise. So they think, well, why would you limit blood flow? But what we're actually doing is we're applying a copper strap either to your arms or to your legs. And everything distal to that strap is getting limited blood flow during the training. But in addition to that, you're trapping the blood distal to the cuff. So when you contract your muscle, you produce metabolites, and it makes your muscles burn, it makes you fatigue. When you have a cuff on, those metabolites can't get past it. So you're kind of bathing your muscle in that metabolic environment, and what it does, you lift a light weight. Typically, it would take a lot of reps to fatigue your muscle. With blood flow restriction, it kind of facilitates that process a little bit more quickly, so that you can fatigue the muscle effectively. So I guess it's kind of a time reducer. But also if you have certain muscles that you struggle to fatigue, or maybe you have poor mind-muscle connection, I think it can help in those instances.
Yeah, it's a shame that I know the only muscle group that I really struggle with a connection and actually feeling it is my rear delts. And it's the one area that we can't really use these because, like Sam was saying, it's got to be distal to the muscle that you are trying to, I guess, fatigue. So today we are actually going to be using this for hamstring curls. Do you want to kind of talk through a little bit about like the pressure that we should be looking for, how you would do it in like the lab environment, and what we need to do if we're just like regular Joes in the gym, but we've got access to some kind of restricted cuff?
Yeah, so in research or in a lab setting, we have pressurized cuffs, so we know exactly how much pressure we're applying. Today we're just using an elastic strap. So this is an elastic band that stretches and has Velcro. So we'll apply pressure, and we want that pressure to be, we say a 7 out of 10 on like a tightness scale. So you want a pressure that causes maybe some discomfort but no pain. Mm-hmm. And essentially what you want to do is you want to kind of occlude venous return, meaning you want to trap the blood distal to the cuff, but you don't necessarily want to impede blood flow to the muscle. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the effect is going to be during that rest period. The pressure just needs to be high enough to limit venous return to trap those metabolites. Mm-hmm. Venous pressure, a lot of people don't know this, it's really, really low. Mm-hmm. So they think venous pressure is diastolic pressure. So if your blood pressure is 120 over 80, mm-hmm. people think venous pressure is 80. Venous pressure is actually like 10 to 20 millimeters of mercury. It's really, really low. So you don't need a lot of pressure to create the effect that we're going for with blood flow restriction.
Okay. So is this going to be really painful?
It's going to be perhaps more painful than normal exercise. Mm-hmm. Discomfort's usually a little bit higher, but yeah. exertion is sometimes lower. So the weight's lighter.
Yeah.
So the exertion might feel different, but there might be slightly elevated discomfort uh-huh. compared to normal unrestricted free flow exercise.
Okay, so just want to repeat. So we're not taking the cuffs off between the sets. They stay on to trap the metabolites inside your muscle, which is basically how we fatigue the muscle. So real quick, what's the rep range? How are we doing this? What's the rest time like? Obviously, that's super important for this particular style of training. So,
yeah, with blood flow restriction, we typically recommend 30 to 40% of your 1RM. Mm-hmm. And that typically is a weight that on your first set, you can get maybe 30 repetitions.
Okay.
Go for failure, but maybe 30 is a good like goal to set. Try to get to 30.
Okay.
And then you want short rest periods. So you want to kind of, again, you're capitalizing on the metabolic environment, so you don't want to fully recover between sets. Mm-hmm. So 30 reps in your first set, rest for 30 seconds, mm-hmm. and then immediately start your second set of exercise.
And how many reps are we doing for the following subsequent
sets? 2, 3, and 4, we typically tell people shoot for 15 reps.
Okay.
You might do more, you might do less, but
is there any downside if I only get 10 reps out in my second, third, or fourth set?
No. No, I mean, again, I think we'd recommend training to or near failure. If you're only getting 2 or 3 reps, the weight's probably too high,
okay.
or the cuff's too tight. So if you're getting nowhere near 30 reps in your first set, 15, 15, 15 on the sets 2, 3, 4, something's too intense, right? The pressure or the weight.
Okay. All right, let's do this.
It might be better, because I don't want to over-tighten it on you. Too tight?
No, it's good.
Tighter than you do it?
Tighter than I do it. Alrighty guys, so I'm jumping in. I am choosing a weight that is probably, I don't know, again, 20% less than what I would choose if I was going to do a regular set of 15. So it is a little bit lighter because again, I want to try and get to about 30 reps for this first set. The pain is already there. So it's like, you know, when you do 4 sets of an exercise, let's imagine you've just done hamstrings. It's kind of the feeling that you get by your last set on those hard, you know, reps, I don't know, 10, 11, 12. It's just constant. So even though I'm resting
4,
right now,
3,
it's still 2, painful.
1, let's go. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Substantially more uncomfortable. So that was 15 reps. I could have probably kept going for one or two more. I was lazy that set. I will go to failure with this set. So 15 is what the number should be. If you can get more, go for it. But if you're getting up to that 20 mark, you probably
3,
need to have more weight.
2, 1,
whew.
Go. 1,
whew.
2, 3. Resist the urge to move.
Yeah. So right now, all I want to do is get up and rip these things off. That's the whole point of this procedure. Meant to be uncomfortable. And we've just got one set too. This is it.
14. Yeah. 15.
You want to get these bad boys off as quickly as possible. Wow. You wait until you do these with your quads, leg extension. That is something else. I feel like I can hardly move my legs. Golly gosh. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, off you go. Come on, all the way out. So, I'm actually going to be skipping exercise 7 that I'd read the list through earlier today. The reason being, I want to wait and see if I'm training tomorrow at the Glute Lab because they have all of the setup for that exercise that is ideal. And I want to show you the correct way and, you know, a compromised or a hybrid version as well. So I'm going to move past that, which means we're onto exercise 8, my last exercise. So this is the, I guess, ankle weight hanging knee raises. So I am going to really challenge myself today and go straight in with the 5 pounds. Again, if you grab yourself a set of these, I guess on Amazon, like I said, they're about 20 bucks. I think less, these ones were only 14. Start light and work your way up until you know that you're comfortable with that weight. It's like any muscle group, you don't want to go in too heavy too soon, otherwise you'll end up sore or potentially like straining something. And your core, if you've had a sore, like DOMS in your core before, it is so uncomfortable. So start light. Okay, so just walking over here was quite amusing, at least was for me. I'm just like, oh, I did not expect that. So I have found myself an appropriate pull-up style bar. Obviously we're not doing pull-ups, but these would be a fantastic option for weighted pull-ups. So traditionally, you know, you probably use the belt with the chain and weight. This is also another way that you can load up your pull-ups if you are looking for an extra challenge. But we'll save those for another day. I'm using my grips so that I can focus on my core. You can either go wide grip or narrow grip, whichever is more comfortable for you. This one doesn't look as aesthetic, but it's a lot more comfortable. Okay, so like I said, I'm challenging myself today with these 5s on each feet, but we'll see. So I'm extending all the way out and I'm trying to get as much spinal flexion as I possibly can. So that means curling my tailbone up as much as possible. Oh, that was such a good stretch. Okay, Sam, you're up. Okay, so Sam's really modest, but this is way too easy for him. So I have seen Sam do, I don't know, close to the world record of like handstand push-ups. He can flag. I'm sure if we just said go find a pole somewhere, he'll just like... So Sam, my question for you is, you're obviously pretty strong through your core and you've done years of gymnastics. Is, number one, this challenging enough for you? My guess is no, or you'd be doing like 50 reps. What would you do instead at your level of strength in your core?
I think leg lifts or toe raises, toes to bar, I guess that's what the CrossFitters call it. Mm-hmm. It's too easy, so.
How many reps would you have to do for it to be effective for you? Because I'm sure there are people listening that are also pretty strong in their core.
I don't know, a lot, like 25 maybe, 30, which just takes too long. So I would probably tend to do weighted things for my core, or just creative things. Different manipulations, like front levers, back levers, those work your core, they're a little bit different. I do like lever pull-ups.
Which is,
I can do those.
Let's see a lever pull-up, guys. Am I going to be in the way?
I don't know if I'm going to kick you.
So does that train your core?
A little bit.
Is that your core as well?
Well.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Because you're combining a pull-up with a lever. So it's core in a different way. It's not like a bunch of ab work, but it's lats and the more holistic core, I guess.
Transverse abdominals, rectus abdominals. Yeah, okay.
And a progression, you can tuck your legs and just do it like that.
Right, that's your fifth set. As you get stronger at these, so I'm obviously doing knee tucks at the moment. I used to be able to do a complete straight leg. There is no chance on this planet that I'd be able to do that right now with these ankle weights, but that's what I would progress to. So over this next 6 weeks of training, my hopes are that I can probably go from 15 reps before I'm getting kind of close to failure, try and get up to 20 or so, and then when I can do that comfortably, that's when I would consider switching up the exercise variation to make it harder. And then I'm probably gonna find that I end up dropping back maybe to 10 to 12. So that's kind of how I would try to progress and would be evidence that you're getting stronger through your core muscles. Well, guys, that is it. I'm not gonna lie, we've been here for like over 2 hours. I have moved so slow today. Oh my God, obviously it's the end of the week. I am so exhausted, but I actually am really glad that I still came in. Definitely not my best session personally. And if truth be told, I've literally done like half of these exercises, just one set. That's how slow I'm moving today. So, I'm meant to be here showing up and turning it up for you. But we can't win them all. So I hope that those exercises were innovative and give you guys some ideas for your own programming. If you are somebody that's choosing to write your own, do go and check out one of my previous videos on YouTube. I actually explain exactly how to set up your own training program for a variety of different goals. So we'll link that video for you if you want to go and take a look at that. And stay tuned for our upcoming challenges. I'm going to be putting in 10 brand new training programs. By the time we have our new, challenge up and running, I'm going to have my awesome new training platform, which is so exciting. But yeah, thank you so much for tuning in. If you guys have got questions, please do make sure you're subscribed to my channel, and I will see you next time.